أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سورة أنزلناها وفرضناها وأنزلنا فيها آيات بينات لعلكم تذكرون. الزانية والزاني فاجلدوا كل واحد منهما 100 جلدة ولا تأخذكم بهما رأفة في دين الله إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر وليشهد عذابهما 2 من المؤمنين. الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة والزانية لا ينكحها إلا زان أو مشرك وحرم ذلك على المؤمنين. Respected listeners, the ayat al-karima which I have just recited before you are the opening verses of Surah An-Nur, that is the chapter of light. The surah was revealed in Medina Munawwara, consisting of 64 verses and 9 rukus. The surah greatly deals with the laws and the ahkam pertaining to veil, that is parda, and to woman. That is why Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote to the people of Kufa, addressing them, he mentions, عَلِّمُوا نِسَاءَكُمْ سُورَةَ النُّورِ, that educate your woman with the chapter of Surah Nur. That is why I took the opportunity in this holy month of Ramadan to, may Allah ta'ala grant us the ability and the tawfiq to benefit maximumly from this chapter. And it is through this medium that Allah has given us of the radio, inshallah, we hope that Allah ta'ala give us the correct ability and the strength to put across maximum what Allah ta'ala has mentioned in this chapter to all our sisters and our brothers. And Allah give us the ability of implementing not only the injunctions of this particular chapter but the injunctions of the entire Quran and the noble teachings of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala commences this chapter in a very unusual way. Allah ta'ala mentions سورة أنزلناها وفرضناها. This is a chapter. Every surah is a surah, but Allah uses the word, the literal word Allah ta'ala uses, سورة. This is a chapter. أنزلناها, which we have revealed. وفرضناها, and the laws that are discussed in this chapter we have made compulsory. In other words, at the very onset, at the very beginning, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala wants us to draw in our minds the attention and the importance of the orders of Almighty Allah and the fact that this is divine. So whatever is going to follow in the various form of ahkam and laws, we must understand that this is coming from Allah ta'ala, which will enable us to surrender and submit to these injunctions and these orders of Almighty Allah. So Allah says suratun, this is a chapter, anzalnaha, which we have revealed, the words also and of course the meaning also and the commentary. Wafaradnaha, and whatever we have discussed in this chapter we have made it compulsory. وَأَنْزَلْنَا فِيهَا آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. And we have revealed in this chapter clear-cut signs. We have discussed many things and great clear signs on the oneness of Almighty Allah and the beauty of Islam, the status of woman, and the various ahkam that Islam has discussed in this chapter. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, so that you can remember, so that you can ponder, so that you can contemplate, so that you can come closer to Almighty Allah and you can be acquainted with the beauty of Islam. Many a times we find today a person judges Islam with his very limited knowledge. If a person comes to South Africa and he stays in South Africa for 1 week and he hardly travels and then he goes back to his country and he gives an incorrect picture of South Africa, then it will be wrong for those people who will accept his verdict on South Africa and judge South Africa according to his limited understanding that his stay in South Africa was for 1 week only. Today our knowledge regarding deen is very limited. Our knowledge regarding the Quran is very limited. So really speaking, how can we explain to someone the beauty of Islam? We hope inshallah through the barakat of the tafsir of these lessons of the Quran Kareem, our knowledge regarding Islam will increase and we will have a better understanding of what Almighty Allah discusses not only in this chapter but in all the other chapters of the Quran as well. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, after giving a brief introduction regarding the importance of this chapter, Allah goes directly to the laws and the ahkam that he is discussing in this chapter. Allah mentions الزانية والزاني فجلدوا كل واحد منهما 100 جلدة. That man and that woman who were found guilty of the evil act of zina and fornication, فجلدوا كل واحد منهما 100 جلدة, then lash both of them, that is the male and female, 100 lashes. Whip both of them 100 lashes. That is the Islamic ruling. Now if we study, zina is something that has been totally prohibited by Islam to such an extent that not only the evil act of fornication, but Allah Ta'ala has also prohibited us to abstain. Allah Ta'ala has also made it compulsory upon us to abstain from those things which will pave the way of zina. For example, looking at the opposite sex. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ النَّاظِرَ وَالْمَنْظُورِ إِلَيْهِ. Allah Ta'ala's curse is on that person who looks, that male who looks at a female, or that female who looks at a male, a strange male and a strange female, of course. And likewise, Allah's curse is on that male who promotes himself so that females, so that strange woman can look at him. And Allah's curse is on that woman who promotes herself so that strange men can look at her. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن. Zina is such an evil act, and it is so disliked by Almighty Allah, that Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a believer is not in the state of iman when he commits zina. In other words, for that period of time, the ulama have written that his iman leaves him and forms an umbrella over him. And after committing the zina, if he once again makes tawbah, then this iman returns to him. So indeed, this is a very evil act. And besides the disobedience of Almighty Allah, it invites many other evils and many other vices. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ma min قوم يظهر فيهم الزنا إلا أخذوا بالسنة. That nation in which zina and fornication will become prevalent, Allah Ta'ala will afflict a drought upon them. That nation in which immorality will become common, it's the words of Ibn Majah, in the first hadith is in Mishkat second volume, on the authority of Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu. والأوجاع التي لم تكن مضت في أسلافهم الذين مضوا. Such illnesses, such diseases, such calamities will come on them, that the thought of that will not even cross the hearts and the minds of the people that came prior to them. The intelligence of their doctors will be snatched away in searching for cure, because this disease will not be linked to any physical source apart from zina. This will be a divine calamity and azab from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Allah mentions in the Quran, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Allah says, do not come close to zina. Do not look at the woman. Do not talk to her. Do not give rise to those things which will pave the way for zina. We find in that nation or that locality in which zina will become common, then the lineage of the children will not be protected, which is the honor and which is the pride of insan, which Allah mentions in the 26th juz of the Quran. Inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. Through nikah, we have protected our lineage, and the child knows what is the name of his father, his grandfather, the tribe and the progeny that he belongs to, where he was born, where his roots originate from. But if zina will become common, then there will be so many children that will have absolutely no lineage, which will then become a common factor between the animal kingdom and insan. And what will be the difference between insan and the animal kingdom? So indeed, this is something that is totally forbidden and disliked by Almighty Allah. And zina is such a thing that the prohibition of this came gradually from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. The initial stages, the first penalty that was highlighted in the Quran regarding zina, Allah mentions, وَالَّتِي يَأْتِينَ الْفَاحِشَةَ مِن نِسَائِكُمْ فَاسْتَشْهِدُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةً مِّنْكُمْ فَإِنْ شَهِدُوا فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ فِي الْبُيُوتِ حَتَّى يَتَوَفَّاهُنَّ الْمَوْتُ أَوْ يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُنَّ سَبِيلًا. Those two people, that is male and female, that were found in the evil act of zina, like Allah discusses after that again, وَالَّذَانِ يَأْتِيَانِهَا مِنْكُمْ فَآذُوهُمَا. If they are found in the evil act of zina, then Allah Ta'ala says, keep them indoors, keep that woman indoor, keep her locked in the house. That was the very first punishment and the first penalty that Islam had prescribed for a woman that was found in zina. For what period of time? حَتَّى يَتَوَفَّاهُنَّ الْمَوْتُ. Until death overtakes her. In other words, when she was found guilty of the evil act of zina, with substantial proof, then she would be kept indoors till she leaves this dunya. أَوْ يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ لَهُنَّ سَبِيلًا. Or until Allah Ta'ala decides something else regarding her. And what does Allah Ta'ala mention regarding the men? فَآذُوهُمَا. Then put some taklif on them, some difficulty on them, without specifying what type of problem or what type of difficulty. Now, in the later years, when this chapter was revealed, when Surah Nur was revealed, then Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned to his sahaba, خذوا عني خذوا عني او ماي صحابة come and take from me, listen to what I have to tell you. And like Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has mentioned, the promise that Allah had made in Surah Nisa, that keep that woman indoors until Allah Ta'ala makes an opening and Allah reveals another hukam. Allah Ta'ala has fulfilled the promise of giving another hukam in the 18th juz of the Quran in Surah Nur, which we are discussing, and we will explain what was the second law that Allah Ta'ala has revealed regarding that woman and that person who were found guilty of the evil act of zina. What was now the law that came down? Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, qad ja'ala Allahu lahunna sabila. Allah Ta'ala has explained a way out for these people. Al-bikru bil-bikri jildu mi'atin wa taghribu ammin. Wa-thayyibu bil-thayyibi jildu mi'atin wal-rajm. That bachelor, in other words, a person that wasn't married, was found guilty of the evil act of zina with a woman that was not married, a spinster, then the punishment and the penalty will be jildu mi'atin, that will be 100 lashes, wa taghribu amin, and exile for 1 year. We will highlight that aspect regarding the exile. The fuqaha have different opinions, and Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahumullah also holds a different view and a verdict regarding that. Regarding the 100 lashes, this is what exactly the ayat karima which I recited before you. Now the word jildun itself means leather. The ulama have written that in those times the lash was generally made out of leather. Or another wajha tasmiya to this is that jildun means skin. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says the person lashing should not lash so hard that it penetrates through the meat, and he should not hit so lightly that it doesn't serve as a penalty. Instead, he should hit with a moderate pace that the person can feel the pain also, and it shouldn't cause too much taklif and pain and harm to the person, and of course accommodating the order of Almighty Allah and making him aware of the consequences of the violation of the order of Almighty Allah. So this ayat karima was revealed, and this order that is of 100 lashes, it pertains to that bachelor who had the evil act of zina with a spinster, that is unmarried male and female. In the event of a muhsan, muhsan is that person who had a nikah performed, a sahih nikah, in the presence of two witnesses, and he's an aqil person, he's an intelligent person, and he had the opportunity of meeting with his partner in seclusion. After a sahih nikah and then meeting with the partner in seclusion, after that, if a person commits zina, then the Islamic ruling to that particular person is that such a person will be pelted to death. So the difference is that if a person was not married and he committed zina, it will be 100 lashes. And of course the penalty, it is just but correct that the penalty has to be more severe for a person that Allah Ta'ala has given him a wife, and Allah has given him a woman through halal nikah, and he can satisfy his desire through the partner that Allah Ta'ala has given him. Then too he leaves this partner that Allah has given him, and then he does the evil act of zina with a strange woman. His penalty will be that he will be pelted to death. We will inshallah explain these very two differences in the light of the incidents that transpired in the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding Hazrat Ma'iza Aslami radiyallahu anhu and Imra'atul Ghamadiyya. That of course Sahaba Ikram Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in wa insan, and it is the mercy of Almighty Allah that practically he completed Islam and he perfected Islam and he showed everything to us. So in the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when this woman had committed zina and she comes to Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the point that I want to highlight here is that it is insan, and we can error and we can make a mistake. But look at the Sahaba Ikram. When this act had happened and this evil was committed, then look at the restlessness that it brought into them. She comes to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Nabi of Allah, inni zanaytu fa aqim alayya al-hadda. I have committed zina, so according to the Islamic ruling, I want you to pelt me, O Nabi of Allah. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who came as a mercy unto mankind, said no, that how can we oppress that child, that masoom child, that fetus that is in the womb of this woman? So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, after you deliver and you give birth to your child, then you must come back. When this woman look at her iman, she rather tolerate the disgrace in this world than the disgrace in the day of Qiyamah. She rather be embarrassed in front of thousands of the people at that time in the presence of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than billions on the day of Qiyamah. She rather clear her account in this world than on the day of Qiyamah. After she delivers that child, we know the love that the mother has for the child. It is unique and no one can understand and comprehend. In fact, Allah Ta'ala has also given the similitude of his love with the love of the mother that she has for her child, because this is a unique love that Allah Ta'ala has placed in the heart of the mother for that child. نبي كريم صلى الله عليه وسلم tells this woman that after this child, now this child is drinking milk, after this child begins eating solids. Look at the mercy of Nabi Karim صلى الله عليه وسلم, accommodating the order of Allah also, and looking at the relevant situation of this woman, and look at the restlessness of this woman, that her bechaini, that this crime is on her, she rather settle it in this dunya. By the way, let me mention one point here is that there are four types of hudud. Hudud means wherein the penalty has been discussed and has been decided by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. One is when a person commits zina. That is the punishment which we are discussing. Number two, when a person steals, which Allah Pak mentions in the sixth juz of the Quran. وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِّنَ اللَّهِ. That male and that female, when they steal, according to Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahumullah, an item which is worth more than 10 dirhams, their hands will be cut off, the right hand, etc., with great detail, as explained to us by Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise, when a person consumes liquor, and it is confirmed that he has taken liquor, then again there is a had where he will be whooped and he will be punished. And if a person had the tuhmat, when a person accuses someone of zina and he doesn't have substantial proof to prove that person guilty of that act of zina, then this person, for accusing this particular person of zina, will also be lashed 80 lashes. So these are four hudud regarding which the penalty has been decided by Almighty Allah. Apart from that, in other vices, and that it is what we refer to as ta'zirat, where the mufti or the qazi, whatever he will find munasib and suitable, he will decide. For example, perhaps he will just reprimand him, perhaps he will put him in jail for a few days, according to the need and according to the situation. This will be left entirely according and up to the mufti to decide, or according to the qazi, which will also be restricted to the bounds of shariat, of course. Now, there's something to discuss here is al-hududu kaffaratun amla. That if a person committed zina and he is pelted or he is lipped or he is lashed and he is whooped according to the Islamic ruling, will this penalty and this punishment that is given to him in the dunya, will this suffice for him in the akhirat, or is this punishment only the punishment of the dunya? If a person was caught stealing and his hands are cut off, now the cutting of his hands, will this pardon his sin in the akhirat as well, or will this only suffice for the penalty in the dunya? According to Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahumullah, repentance is of paramount importance. So if a person was caught stealing and his hands are cut off, but he doesn't repent to Allah, then the crime and the punishment of the akhirat will be separate. Yes, if his hands are cut off and he repents to Almighty Allah, then we hope in the mercy of Almighty Allah that he will be protected from the punishment of the akhirat as well. Some ulama and some fuqaha are of the opinion, like Imam Shafi rahimahumullah, that when his hands are cut off, then the mere fact that his hands have been cut, this will suffice as the punishment in this dunya and in akhirat, and this itself will be a form of tawbah and repentance. Wallahu a'lamu bis-sawab. I was mentioning the incident of that woman, Imra'atul Ghamidiyya. When she comes back to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then commands the sahaba to pelt her, and in the process she passes away. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then commands the sahaba to give ghusl, and then he says Allahu Akbar, and he's about to perform the janaza namaz, when Sayyidina Umar taps him on his shoulder and says, Ya Rasulallah, tusalli alayha wa qad zanat. Are you going to perform the janaza namaz of a woman that has committed zina and adultery? My respected listeners, let us pause and understand what was the answer given by Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O Umar, لقد تابت توبة لو قسمت بين 70 من أهل المدينة لوسعتهم. Allah's qasam, this woman has made such tawbah in the court of Allah, and it is so readily accepted by Allah that on the tawbah of this one woman, wallah, 70 people's maghfirat can be made. She hasn't only had her sins forgiven, but she had elevated herself through this tawbah, that on her tawbah 70 people's maghfirat can be made. So we are sinning and we are all committing sins, but after the sins we can make such a tawbah that it can actually uplift our standard and our maqam and our martaba in the eyes of Almighty Allah. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, with relevance to the very same occasion and to this very same ayah, he was sitting on the minbar of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he came into a josh and he mentioned, إن الله تعالى بعث محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم بالحق وأنزل عليه الكتاب فكان مما أنزل الله عليه آية الرجم قرأناها وعيناها وعقلناها فرجم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورجمنا بعده. He says that Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and Allah Ta'ala had sent him with the complete religion. And Allah Ta'ala revealed on him the divine scripture that is the Quran. And in this Quran, Allah revealed many ahkam and many laws. And amongst the many laws were the ayat of Rajam, that is that person who was found guilty of the evil act of zina and fornication will be pelted to death. That is, if he is muhsan, as I elaborated, his nikah was performed in the presence of two witnesses. Then Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu says, فَأَخْشَىٰ إِن طَالَ بِالنَّاسِ زَمَانٌ I fear it mustn't happen that by the passing of time someone must come in this dunya أَن يَقُولَ قَائِلٌ and he must say مَا نَجِدُ الرَّجْمَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ We have read the Quran cover to cover but we cannot find any ayat in the entire Quran confirming the fact that that person that is found that adulterer will be pelted to death I fear that it mustn't happen that by the passing of time people negate this order of Allah فَيَظِلُّ Allah's قسم they will go astray بِتَرْكِ فَرِيضَةٍ أَنزَلَهَا اللَّهُ تَعَالَى by neglecting one order which Allah has decided and Allah Pak has mentioned in the Quran. And in one riwayat of Nasa'i it comes that Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu says Inna la najidu min ar-rajmi buddan There is no escape from this order of Almighty Allah. There is no way we can come out, abstain from zina. If you will commit the evil act of zina and it is confirmed with substantial proof and gawah, then rest assured we are going to exercise this order of Almighty Allah. Fa innahu haddun min hududillah. Allah's qasam, this is one had from the hudud of Almighty Allah. Qad rajama Rasulullah, Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pelted in his zamana, that adulterer and that adulteress who was found guilty of this act of zina. وَرَجَمْنَا بَعْدَهُ And this is an act that was found in the Khilafat of Sayyidina Abu Bakr. And this will remain in my zamana. And wallah, it will remain till the day of Qiyamah. Then he comes into Josh and he says, وَلَوْلَا أَن يَقُولَ قَائِلُونَ أَنَّ عُمَرَ زَادَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ مَا لَيْسَ فِيهِ لَكَتَبْتُ فِي نَاحِيَةِ الْمُصْحَفِ Wallah, if it wasn't out of the fear that people will say that Umar is erring in the book of Almighty Allah, I would have written next to this ayat in the Quran Kareem all the ahadith and all the episodes and the incidents confirming this very same fact, that is Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pelted that muhsan, that adulterer and that adulteress, so that people must know this is a thing that is confirmed by Allah, this is a penalty that is decided by Allah, no person can put his finger in it and no person has any opportunity to interfere with this order of Almighty Allah. But if I will add this in the book of Allah, I fear people will say I am adding on the book of Allah. And I testify وَشَهِدَ عُمَرُ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ وَعَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنُ بْنُ عَوْفٍ وفلان وفلان أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رجم ورجمنا بعده Allah's قسم I testify that it is a reality. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is with me and all the eminent Sahaba, the galaxy of 124,000 Sahaba sanctioned this verdict of minds, which is not a verdict of minds but it is a divine decision of Allah which was confirmed by the noble teachings and the practices of Nabi Kareem صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this is a reality which Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala discusses in the Quran. Now if we find something very unusual in this ayat al-Karimah, if we study in the other places of the Quran, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala discusses by saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. And in that Allah Ta'ala refers to the males and the females. But here on this instance, Allah Ta'ala did not make iktifa on Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, but instead Allah discusses the woman separately and Allah discusses the man separately. So this is one astonishing factor. And number two, something more astonishing. When it comes to the aspect of stealing, then Allah says وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقَطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا That male that steals and that female that steals, Allah Ta'ala commences with the crime of a male. But when it comes to the act of zina, then Allah commences with the crime of a woman, الزَّانِيَةُ That adult first, whereas in the other ayat karima the woman comes zimnan with the men. Ya Allah Ta'ala discusses the woman and Allah Ta'ala discusses the woman before the men also. The commentators have highlighted many reasons for this. I will discuss and highlight only one. That is that Allah Ta'ala has placed great amount of sharam and haya and modesty in a woman. And it will be totally incorrect on behalf of a woman who comes in this dunya with haya and modesty, that if she will take the courage of disobeying Allah and losing and breaking all the boundaries of haya and modesty, not by looking at a man or speaking to a man, but actually sharing the bed with a strange man, this will be totally incorrect. Of course, it will be incorrect on behalf of the man as well. But that woman, that she has so much haya, that when we read Abwabun Nikah in the books of Hadith, that girl who is asked regarding one proposal that has come to her, and if she is asked that, are you happy with this proposal? And if she only smiles and she remains silent, as sukutu yadullu ala al-ijab, then her silence and her smile is an indication of approval. Why? Because the hadith explains to us, she is full of haya and modesty. Perhaps she cannot take the courage of saying, yes, I want to get married. So she observes silent. وَإِذْنُهَا سُمَاتُ وَسُمَاتُهَا إِذْنُهَا. Her silence will be her permission. So that woman whose nikah was confirmed with her silence, because of her modesty, she could not break the ice and she could not utter it verbally that, yes, I love this person or I am ready to give my life in his nikah. That woman who came with so much haya, she has now taken the courage of breaking all the boundaries of haya and she went to the extent of actually sharing the bed with a strange person. So Allah Ta'ala commences this ayat by saying, الزانيه والزاني فجلدوا كل واحد منهما 100 جلده. Allah says, give them 100 lashes, as I explain who this refers to. And what does Almighty Allah mention? When you are lashing them and you are carrying out this order of Almighty Allah, وَلَا تَأْخُذْكُمْ بِهِمَا رَأْفَةٌ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. That while you are punishing them and you are carrying out the order of Almighty Allah, let not pity overtake you and do not be kind to them by relieving them of this particular penalty or by exempting them of this particular penalty. Because by you being kind to them, wallah, you are oppressing the entire creation. To accommodate the pleasure of these people and to be kind and to be loyal to them, you are giving rise to this vice. And if you will overlook it, then this evil act will become common in society. And by doing so, you will be opening the doors for people to attack the izzat of our daughters, our sisters, our mothers, our aunties. So Allah Ta'ala says, if you fear Almighty Allah, then when you are punishing them and you are pelting them, not to prove, like one person was being pelted and one sahabi said, Akhzaak Allah, may Allah disgrace you. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, oh my sahabi, control your tongue. Allah Ta'ala has not told us to criticize this person. We are pelting him or her, not because we hate him, because we love Allah we are doing this. One sahabi was caught stealing. He came before Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. His hands were being cut. My Nabi started crying. One sahabi tapped him on his shoulder. O Nabi of Allah, you brought the Quran to us. You are telling us that we must cut the man's hands. Now when we are cutting his hands, you are crying. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Subhanallah, what does he say? Oh my sahabi, being my ummati, if I am not going to cry, who will cry? Yes, the order of Allah will prevail, but because it is happening to my ummati, if I will not feel the pain and the agony, who is going to feel the pain and the agony? So we will not criticize him, we will not criticize her, we will not express our hatred for them. We will establish the order of Almighty Allah. And Allah says, if iman is in your heart, then that iman should demand from you that you do not delay the order of Almighty Allah, you do not become lenient in the order of Allah. And if you are becoming lenient in the order of Allah, then in kuntum tu'minuna billah, that means that there is a deficiency in your iman. Because if you are bringing iman in Allah, then that same Allah demands you must lash him or you must pelt him according to the difference as it was elaborated earlier on. What does Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala mention? Something very unusual again. وَلْيَشْهَدَ عَذَابَهُمَا طَائِفَةٌ مِّنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We find when it comes to other sins and other evil and other vice, we are taught to conceal and hide the faults of our Muslim brothers. But in this instance, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Almighty Allah mentions in the Quran that while they are being pelted and while they are being given 100 lashes, one group of the Muslim ummah must come and witness this. This mustn't be done in hidden. It mustn't be done in low profile. It must be done when the venue is decided and the time is decided. Then it must be announced and the people must come and see the consequences of the violation of the order of Allah. فَجَعَلْنَاهَا نَكَالًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهَا وَمَا خَلْفَهَا وَمَوْعِظَةً لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So that it can serve as an eye-opener for the people until the day of Qiyamah. Look at the disgrace of today and think of the disgrace of tomorrow, and let people understand, wallah, if we sit and ponder and contemplate, if one case of this nature comes before insan and this order of Allah will prevail and is established, after that which young boy and which young girl will take the guts and the courage of violating the order of Allah and making zina? Whatever we are seeing today is because of neglecting and deviating from the orders of Allah. It is because of the absence of the ta'lim of Quran and Hadith that today we are living in such a polluted environment that a person actually sees that person who comes and does evil to his daughter, yet he is living in an environment that he doesn't do anything. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in the words of Muslim, three people will never go to Jannat. Ad-dayyuth. Who is a dayyuth? Alladhi yadkhulu ala ahlihi ar-rijal. That person whose wife entertains strange men. We make dua to the Almighty Allah. May He protect us from the evil act of zina. May Allah purify our environment. May Allah give us the teachings. May Allah give us the ability of implementing the noble teachings of Nabi الكريم صلى الله عليه وسلم wherein he mentions لأن يطعن في رأس أحدكم بمخيط من حديد خير له من أن يمس امرأة لا تحل له. Oh my sahaba, it is better for you that a steel nail be driven into your head than you touch the hand of a strange woman. My respected brothers out there in the outside world, many a times we are confronted in such an environment. Allah protect me also, Allah protect you. It was the words of Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم الدنيا حلوة خضرة وإن الله مستخلفكم فيها فينظر كيف تعملون فاتقوا الدنيا واتقوا النساء. Allah is going to put you in this dunya and Allah is going to test you. Keep yourself away from the temptations of the dunya and the temptations of women. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala protect us from zina and may Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the tawfiq of implementing the injunctions of the Quran and repenting to Almighty Allah, and may He inspire our hearts with the noor of the Quran. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.